Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Institution of Engineers, Sri Lanka. On behalf of the Building Services Engineering Sectional Committee, I shall be introducing our guest speaker, Engineer Kosala Kamburadeniya, who will be presenting this evening's public lecture on MEP space planning. Engineer Kamburadeniya is working currently as an independent consultant and is a veteran of 23 years' experience in the field of building services engineering, power generation, operation and maintenance, and process improvement in semi-government and private sector organizations. His qualifications range from Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering, Postgraduate Diploma in Industrial Engineering, and a Master's in Business Administration. To further strengthen his claim as speaker today, his achievements go on to read Attorney at Law of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka, Council Member of the IESL, and Chairman of the Electrical and Electronics Sectional Committee since 2014-2015 sessions. So without further ado, may I ask you all to welcome our highly distinguished speaker, Engineer Kamburadeniya, to stage with a warm round of applause, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Reza. I would like to thank Building Services Sectional Committee for inviting me to deliver this lecture. Okay, let's start. More specifically, let's share what I know with you. I will start with how CIBSC has defined or explained the role of design engineer. It says the responsibility of a design engineer to satisfy the owner's brief by providing the most appropriate technical solution and same time achieving, I mean, they should address the capital cost, economic cost in use, reliability and effective maintenance strategy within whatever constraints placed on the project. Every design should carry out according to the maintenance policies defined by the owner and be based on sound comprehensive advice or previous experience which is viable for the future. So when as a design engineer, when we have this responsibility, so we must do our MEP planning process correctly, because we have to make sure the correct equipment are purchased and correctly installed in the right place, and those are in a maintainable position, and gives the client the minimum operational cost. So when you take the design process, actually, so we have basically initially the owner gives us a brief what he wants. We call as design owner's brief. Generally it doesn't happen most of the projects in Sri Lanka. Based on the owner's brief, what he needs, then the architects, the main designer, develops a conceptual design. He starts with a concept, what he needs, what type of building he needs, what are the areas, spaces he need, approximate area, ceiling heights, that sort of thing. At that point, actually, MEP engineer has a role. He also has to decide what sort of services to be incorporated to achieve the requirement mentioned in the client's brief, what clients need. He has to do that one. So in doing that one, actually, MEP engineer has to get engaged in this assignment from the conceptual stage. Unfortunately, in Sri Lanka, I don't think that most of the MEP engineers get involved in this conceptual step. What happens is most of the time, owner and architects do the conceptual design, and then give it to the MEP engineer or MEP consultants to do the rest. So during this conceptual design, as I mentioned, selection and description of ME systems to be used. If I take example, what type of chillers we have to use, transformers, whether we are using generators, and whether what sort of redundancy we need, and everything need to be decided. And also, most importantly, we need to decide what are the space requirement for those required services. Basically, at conceptual stage, these space requirements are done by thumb rules, because we haven't done at that by that time. We haven't done any detailed design, so we go by thumb rules. Then we go to the schematic stage, the second stage. In the schematic stage, actually all conceptuals are converted to scale drawings. Normally schematics design, we get site layouts, site plans, building layouts, floor plans, elevations and sections, service routes, and roughly dimensioned service routes, and roughly dimensioned plant rooms. Then we go to design development, the final design. We detail all these areas, and we do the final design calculation, and then we decide the exact equipment sizing. So then tendering, construction, testing and commissioning, and defect liability follow. MEP space requirement basically depend on so many factors. That's the usage of usage. One thing is usage of the building. If it's a stores, there's no space, no ceiling space. If you have a server room, if it's an IT related business, we will have a server room. And then server rooms actually needs a, generally we have raised floors. And cinema, or in a ballroom, we have a catwalk, because there will be a lot of services on top of the ceiling. So the usage of the itself space requirement is mainly it's a dependent factor of usage of the building. Then location of the building, whether it's in Sri Lanka, the UK, cooling or heating, that also depend, and that sort of so many things depends on the location. And then distribution of building. If it's a single block, actually the space requirement will be different. And if it is a scattered building, like a chalet, so you will have a different space requirement. In a single block, actually you will have one main distribution room and probably floor distribution both. But if you have a scattered building, you will have to have different number of sub distribution board in each building. So MEP space planning is dependent on these factors. Why we really need space planning? Because spaces are really expensive, especially if you take Colombo area. So it's really expensive. And also we need to locate the plant rooms in a pleasing manner. We don't want to go and put the plant room at the entrance. Architect never will allow us to put the plant room at the entrance. So what he tries is try to put it at the one boundary of the premises. So we have to come to a compromise. So architecturally, it has to be in a place. We have to locate in a pleasing manner. Then the space provided must be fit for the purpose. The space must be capable of using for the intended purpose. Installation must be sustainable, and MEP installation must be sustainable and deliver expected service. And it has to be low operational cost and serviceability. We need to achieve serviceability. If we can't achieve the serviceability, if we can't operate at low operational cost, actually the client's intention investment is going to be not successful. So space planning has a very important role. Why we cannot do without space planning? Yes, we can do. I mean, as most of the projects happen in Sri Lanka, we can do we can construct building without space planning. What will happen then during the construction period? Actually, cannot implement the most suitable design. We won't be able to implement the most suitable design. What we have to do is we have to accommodate our services within the space available. And then actually during the construction, as there's no proper plan, no proper space, whoever installed the first services, they will go and install everything in the service logs. So the rest of the people who install later, they won't have any space. Actually, this has happened so many projects. Actually, if I take an example, there's a project international hotel chain which has more than 200 hotels. In their building, they did the entire civil work without paying proper attention to the services. There's no place for the generator in that building. There's no space for the transformer. The owner has thought the property can be run with a transformer less than 1000 kVA. Actually, today the property needs 2500 kVA. So as a result, what happened? They have to shift the transformers and the generators the other side of the road, which has a length of 110 meters. So imagine what happens when you shift the transformers and generators 110 meters, the voltage drop, the cost of cables and digging the roads and everything. So I think roughly they had to spend like very large amount, like 30 million or something additional because of this one. So this is one result. So during the construction, we have to suffer. And during the operation, you pack everything. When you don't have space, you pack everything into available duct, so you don't have access. The maintenance staff will not be able to even replace certain items, and they will frustrate actually. And high operational cost, because we have not done the proper design. We have fixed our equipment where it is possible. The classic example is sometimes actually light fittings. Everyone is going behind LED lights now, but actually LED lights are very good, long lasting and energy efficient. But there are so many factors that we have to consider when you fix LED lights, because LED light has a driver. It emits a lot of heat energy. So we have to think about thermal management of LED lights. So what happens is some architects actually they just keep provisions in the soffit. They embed it into the soffit. So the heat generated in the LED driver, there's no place to escape. So if although we say 30,000 hours, actually within 5-6 months LED has to be replaced. So those are additional operational costs. So if we thought of those things actually, so definitely we can get the maximum benefit of the equipment. And also we compromise safety and unsatisfied users finally, because sometimes actually improper placing, you will get smell, unnecessary sound, noise, vibration, and sometimes actually when something happens, even the designers may go to courts. This owner might sue. And not badly built property will not have resale value. Okay, space. When you talk about space, what are the spaces we are talking about? Mainly the plant room, where MEP equipments are located. And then service containments from plant room, how the services are transferred, distributed to other areas or the same building or separate building. Trenches, ducts, ceiling voids, and water tanks, cable trays, and fuel storage. Plant room is a place where actually it's a dedicated place where we have all our equipment. Equipment in a plant room, like chillers, cooling towers, boilers, transformers, generators, and as I said, plant room can be central, or we have several plant rooms. There may be several plant rooms in distributed locations, depending on the site. Consideration what are the consideration, what should we think of when we plan a plant room? So we have to locate the plant room at a minimum distance to all end users. As I said, then we will be able to reduce the voltage drop. We will be able to maintain the voltage drop. Otherwise, we have to increase the cable cross section. Finally, it will end up with a higher cost. And then pressure losses, pressure losses in the pipes, additional material, everything we can be reduced. But this has a limitation. So we have to come to a compromise with the architect for this one. But we have to find the ideal place for that one. And then we have to keep provision, generally 15% to 20% provision for future expansion. Accessibility of vehicles, availability of roads, and whether we can maneuver large vehicles, because we have to sometimes bring and take back certain large equipment. We can have the plant room. Sometimes actually we have seen plant rooms are located in rooftops. Can be done. Then we have to consider how we transfer these machineries when there's a requirement for a maintenance. And also plant rooms, definitely we have to have flow drains when there's a spillage, washing and cleaning requirements. And whether most importantly, we want to know how the plant is how required to operate, whether they need a redundancy. Certain plants, certain operations, actually they need N plus one configuration. That means if you want to run, if the property is run with two generators, if the property is required 1000 kVA, if it is run with two generators, 500, 500, we have to have one additional generator if there is a breakdown in one generator. So always some operate, like hotel operators, like Tilt and Marriott, and they always ask for N plus one redundancy configuration. So our space planning must take into consideration that one. And then the other requirement is level of located above the plant rooms, has to be located above the flood level. And we need to see the noise regulations, whether it is affected to the neighbors, especially when we have generators, we have environmental regulation. We want to comply with the environmental regulation, and also the occupants of the property must not be affected by noise, vibration, and fumes and odor. Whether in a hotel they are disturbed by fumes and odor, like STP, open type of STP can easily give fumes. In MEP, when you talk about MEP services, MEP ducts and trenches, basically the purpose of providing service ducts are, so it provides a concealed way but still accessible for repairs, and also it protects, because we are running all the services in a duct or trench, it protects from external damages and reduce noise, and it reduces transfer heat to the other areas and minimize the damage if there's a leak to the rest of the areas. So when you talk about ducts, the ducts can be categorized as horizontal ducts, main ducts, horizontal ducts or trenches, vertical ducts, and secondary ducts, which are branch off from the main horizontal duct or main vertical duct. We can have external ducts as well as ducts within the building. When ducts are external, we need to make sure ducts are weatherproof. Certain installations, if ducts are not properly sealed, water can get into the gate, can get into ducts, and even lot of damages can happen for the electrical equipment. And when you have ground ducts, we want to make sure there are barriers to avoid water entering into the ducts, and also waterproofing, and also not to enter animals. And also we want to make sure when we have ducts, when we have ducts in fire compartments, fire compartments, we have to have minimum openings to the fire compartment, fire rated compartment. But it's a vertical ducts are vertical ducts. Actually, in vertical ducts, if there's a fire, it will be the easiest way to spread a fire if we have not properly done the vertical duct without a fire barriers, fire separation. Also, when you have the ducts, we must try to avoid escape routes, hazard areas and clean areas. Adequate control for noise transmission between different parts of the building. So vertical duct can easily transmit noise between the floors. Also, electrical in a duct, electrical services should not run with the liquids, like plumbing and electrical services should not run in say in duct. And also you must think what will happen if there's a leakage in one of the services in the duct. Adequate drain points must be provided in the duct, that must be thought of. And hot water, steam should be properly insulated within the ducts. Hot pipes should not run with the closer to the chilled water pipes and communication cables. Those are ELV and low voltage cables, unless you use a separate and special separations like skirting trunkings. You use a special separation so you can run within 400 millimeter. Unless you use something like that, you have to maintain 300 millimeter. So then actually you need a larger, wider duct size. So access for ducts is very important. You have to have access for all the joints where the fittings are installed. Sometimes actually we have come across, we know providing certain requirements for access is not very frequent. In such a situation actually what we do is we don't provide access opening. Sometimes we destroy the open, like it's a ceiling void, sometimes actually gypsum ceilings. What we do is sometimes we cut the ceiling and we do the repairs. So it is up to you to decide whether you need to see how many openings, access covers required for the service ducts. And for the access doors, vertical access doors, you should not use sliding doors. Those must be hinge completely removed or completely removable. And also ducts must open outwards from the duct interior. Hinge hatch cover of a floor should open to 180% or be provided with a self-locking device to hold in an open position. That is for the safety reason. Doors of the ducts are large enough to be entered, should be openable from the inside of the duct. If someone can enter into the duct, those are large ducts, they must be able to, when they go inside the duct, they must be able to open the duct from inside. Heavy trench covers normally, I mean, you don't use securing, locking. What you do is you normally use concrete or tiles. Access covers and doors should be preferably secured by budget locks. Budget locks are normally with the single key. You can open maintenance team can open those doors. This is an idea about positions, sizes and positions of the access opening. So horizontal duct, recommended minimum sizes for duct horizontal openings are like 600 by 600 wide, or 600 wide and 600 high. These two are horizontal ducts. When it comes to vertical ducts, the openings must be preferably 600 wide and 1800 high. If it is not possible to achieve that one, at least you have to have 1400 millimeter high. These are some work positions. So how they are going to do the maintenance, depend on how they are going to do maintenance, team is going to do the maintenance. You need to provide these heights and lengths and widths for maintenance. In prone position, actually you need this position, you need 2500 millimeter a person to lay down and work, and to raise his head he needs 450 millimeter. And knee down position, actually you need 1400 and 1100 per 1100 for person to work with his tools. Prowling 1500 width and 790, and this is again explaining about stand, knee and sit positions. Squat you need 690 and 1200, and passage you need 2100, and this is the absolute minimum. You have to have minimum 550 width, preferably 750 width, and stoop 900 width and 900 height. So when it comes to ladders, actually, so the minimum ladder width minimum is 380, you can't see the width, optimum 490. Distance between side walls, you have to have 600 millimeter distance between side walls, and rung distance is 225, that is C, and the minimum diameter rung diameter is 220 to 40. In this arrangement, width for one person is 600 to 750, width for two people it's 1100. Riser, that is B, 184, and thread is 240 width of the step. And in this case, actually width is 530 to 600 with handrails, 600 between minimum side walls, thread again 100, riser 250 maximum, thread width is 80 to 150. So optimal angles are given here. If it's an inclined surface, actually ramp, the inclination should not exceed 20 degrees. Vertical services. The vertical, you can have a vertical services in the surface or is this type. So it shows if you want sound insulation, so you can have insulation panel in front of this. This is again recess medium size pipe and cables, and this is partially recessed vertical duct. In both cases, actually you have insulation board at rear. And T angle pipe is all these pipes are fixed to a TO angle pipe. This is fairly large duct, actually this built out for large pipes. This is, there are two ducts, vertical ducts. As I said, as we can't run pipes and cables together, we have separated cables and pipes. So this is a typical arrangement. This is a typical arrangement. Vertical duct, you have to have, always you have to have a larger width and small depth, because what you can reach is the elbow to finger diameter distance for maintenance. What happens is, most of experience is, actually most we have come across lot of cases, what we get is actually duct like this. You get a small width and depth like 1.5 meters or 2 meters, so no one can reach the services pipes at the other end. So actually it's a utter waste of space. So and on top of it, actually sometimes what happens is the suck, you get a this type of narrow width deep duct, and especially hotels, you get every two rooms, you get a duct in between those two. That's a typical arrangement. So sometimes structural engineer, he puts a column, structural column, in the middle of the duct. So you have 6 inch from this side and this 6 inch from the other side. Even you can't put your hand actually. So no, these are realities actually. There are so many hotels actually. I can show you. I don't want to tell you names. There are so many hotels actually with these arrangements. In the middle, you get in the structural column, in the service duct. Horizontal distribution. You can have skirting trunking, typically 100 millimeter height, 450 millimeter, 4 to 6 inches. And flow trunking, you can embed in the cables in the flow. Generally, you need 65 to 70 millimeter. If you have to have that. You take that from the beginning actually. Then recess flow. You get recess flows in IT rooms mainly, where a lot of cables need to be run, and lot of data cables and power cables need to be run. And also in IT rooms, especially server rooms actually, airflow is generally actually comes out from the flow. Because of air conditioned ducts are also placed here, so all the services are going here. Generally, these phase flows are like you get 600 2x2 panels, and it can vary from 100 millimeter to 600 millimeter. Then suspended ceiling, again same. Minimum height, as I mentioned, preferable height is 500 millimeter, clear of beam bottom to ceiling. If you get 500 millimeter actually, you can without any problem you can run your services. Then floor wrenches. Normally floor wrenches are fitted with continuous covers. Generally floor wrench is height is 1 meter. You can have the trench covers in stone, reinforced concrete or material. This must be light enough to take off by one person. External trenches actually, what you do is you cover it with a mortar to seal from mortar. Then still further, you can run your horizontal services through holes in the structural elements and notches. Holes, you know, these are holes, these are notches. With the consent of the structural engineer, definitely we have to get the consent from the structural engineer. Holing could be allowed generally at the center line of the structural element or neutral axis, where the compressive and tensile strength are minimal. Notches may not be provided as it affects the strength of the structure, may need oversizing the structural members. Generally, holes and notches avoid span and closer to the span where maximum bending occur, and closer to the support where maximum shear occurs. So these are the thumb rules where you can generally place with the approval of the structural engineer. This is the joint. This is the depth of a beam. So you can have the notch in this region 0.17 to 0.25 span, 0.25. of the joystick, and the depth of a joist is like 1/8 of the height of the joist. Hole diameters maximum, structural element depth into 0.25, 25% of that one. Holes are minimum of 3 into diameter parts. 3 times of the diameter you have to maintain. 3 times of the minimum hole diameter in between the holes. And holes located between
0.25 to 0.4 times of the span from the support. So you can have it there. So those are rough guidelines.
Okay. Let's go to the electricity, how we need to plan electricity. So that's about the vertical ducts and horizontal ducts. Let's see what we need to think about electricity or power supply when we do the space planning. So generally power capacities we have in Sri Lanka 15 ampere three phase, I think it's only in Colombo, 30 ampere single phase everywhere in Sri Lanka, 30 ampere three phase everywhere in Sri Lanka, 60 ampere 3 phase everywhere in Sri Lanka, 10 kVA, 6.9, 21 and 42 kVA. These are categorized as retail supply.
And then in Colombo, only in the Colombo area actually, we get 100 ampere three phase supply, that is 70 kVA. It's categorized as bulk supply, but you don't want to provide that, you don't want to install a transformer to get 100 ampere three phase power supply in Colombo city area. Then you get 160 three phase supply, that is 112 kVA, that's also categorized as bulk supply. Only in Colombo, you don't want a transformer for the 160 ampere power supply. But in other areas, other than Colombo city, if you want to have a connection more than 60 ampere three phase, you have to have a separate transformer. So you have to go for minimum. Those days actually minimum transformer capacity is 100 kVA. Now they have CB has I think 80 kVA and 90 kVA as well. Then if you want to go for more than that actually, up to 1000 kVA, it will be a bulk supply, LT metering, low voltage metering. But if you want to have 100 kVA in Colombo area, I'll come to Colombo. If it is above 1000 kVA, it's a bulk supply, HT metering. You have to have your own HT room, transformers and medium voltage switchgear to have anything above 1000 kVA.
In Sri Lanka, we have two voltages for distribution, 11 kVA and 33 kVA. In Colombo city, we have 11 kVA underground meter. Space requirement, CB meter room, Colombo city. Up to 160, you don't want any 160 ampere, that is 112 kVA, you don't want anything, you can get the direct supply from Colombo city. But if it is more than that one, up to 1000 kVA, whether it's 200 kVA or 250 kVA, you have to have 5 by 5 meter space in consumer's property. So that is CEB to install a transformer in your property and they will give you the connection. I think now actually the minimum capacity of the transformer they install is 630 kVA. So you have to provide 5 by 5 space and they will install, CEB will install a transformer in your property which is belong to them. And they will redistribute it from the neighboring area. Other areas, approximately, so it's like 3 meter by 2.5 meters, because you need to have those are up to 1000 kVA. You have to have approximately 3 by 2.5 meter. That's a small room. CB or LECO, they will install their meter equipments inside this room. And transformer can be placed probably above the pole mounted. You can mount it on the pole up to 250 kVA. And if it is above, you have to have one of the concrete pin or above the slab of this room. This is drawing given by CEB, which indicates 2.4 meter by 3 meter room for their metro. That is for us supply outside in Sri Lanka, outside in Colombo, at 630,000 kVA.
Then this is Colombo city area. When you want anything below 1000 kVA, so you have to have provide 5 by 5 meter room for CEB to install their transformer and their RMU, main unit, and their LT panels. So they will take the power supply to RMU, transformer, and then LT panel. From LT panel, they will again distribute it back to other areas as well.
On top of this, if you want 1000 kVA,
above 1000 kVA, you have to have room for your own transformers, your high voltage and medium voltage equipment. It can be either Colombo city, definitely it will be an indoor station, but in out station you can have transformers, outdoor transformers or indoor transformers, whatever you want.
So that space requirement you need to take from the manufacturer's detail, from the transformer length and width, and allowing space for maintenance. Then these are some indications about the clearance you require for buildings to overhead lines not exceeding 1000 volts. So you need to vertical distance, you have to maintain a 2.5 meter and horizontal distance from a building to overhead line 1.5 meter. Between 1000, that is, this comes normally three phase 400 volts comes under this one. So 11 kVA, you need 2.7 and 1.5. 11 kVA to 33 kVA, 3 to 2.5. So if you are taking your overhead high voltage line, so you have to be cautious about this one. Your route to be decided based on these clearances. Then this is the clearance between vertical and horizontal distance, low voltage overhead line. Clearance from tree to overhead lines, that is 2.7 meters and 0.1. This insulated cable, these are not insulated cables. And medium voltage, vertical distance and horizontal distance. Then let's look at the space requirement. How we have to provide space for the electrical panels. Electrical working space, which is measured from the enclosure front, must not less than the distance contained in the below table. So I'll this is easier to explain the
this depth of the working space. Condition one is actually, this is a live exposed part and this is a insulated metal. This is a grounded one. Second one, actually this is a live part, and both are live. In these three cases actually, the working space from the enclosure must not be less than this is shown in this one. About table, that is three feet. 3 feet and 3.5 inches, and 3 feet and 3 to 3.5 feet, and in this case 3 to 4 feet. Right hand side, actually, if you can access this panel, all the items in the panel from front, you don't want. There is no requirement to keep provision. Access provision from side and back.
You need to have minimum of 30 inches working space. Width of the working space must be minimum of 30 inches. But in no case less than the width of the equipment. So either you have to have minimum of 30 or width of the equipment in front of a equipment. But you can't you
you need to have 30 inches in everywhere, but you can't overlap 30 inches of this space with the other one. So you have to have separate 30 inches in front of each
panel of equipment.
So working space, in all cases, the working space must be sufficient with depth and height to permit all equipment doors to open 90 degrees. So you have 30 inches here, and you must be able to open the
door by 90 degrees. The height of the working space in front of the equipment must not be less than 6.5 feet.
With the equipment, you have to maintain 6.5 feet.
Or if the height of the equipment is more than that one, you have to maintain that height. Equipment such as raceways, cables, wireways, cabinets, panels, and so on can be located above or below electrical equipment, but must not extend more than 6 inches into the working space.
So working space you can extend only 6 inches, but you can't extend more than that one any part of the equipment.
For the equipment rated more than 1200 and more, and over more than 6 feet wide, you need to have 2 exits, an entrance to an egress from 2 by 6.5 feet is required at each end of the working space.
If the capacity is more than 1200, you would have two minimum entrances.
But there's exception for that one.
If you can maintain a double working space here, initially it was like 3.5. If you can maintain double working space here, and also from the edge of this panel to the door is more than again the working space, so you can limit one door.
The working space required by this section must be clear at all,
the working space must be clear all the time. You can't store anything here, but rest of the area, I mean, if this is the electrical room, rest of the area, working space, you can store
whatever you want, not whatever you want, actually safe items, not hazardous for the electrical system.
This is the equipment rated more than again 1200 actually, or more, personal doors, actually these doors, located less than 25 feet from the nearest edge of the working space must open in the direction of egress. So these two doors must be open in the direction of egress outside and have panic hardware in these two. So if these doors are located less than 25 meters from the nearest edge of the working space, then you have to have panic hardware for these two doors. And all the equipments, panel boards, switchboards, and above the equipment, I'm not talking about the working space, must have exclusive dedicated space of up to 6 feet above the equipment. You can have foreign systems can be located above dedicated equipment, but you need to have protection. Like even you can have plumbing lines, but you need to have dipans to protect in case of there's a leak. You can have sprinklers in a electrical room, but you can't have sprinkler pipes in a electrical room. Sprinkler pipes cannot go right above the electrical panels.
those are the electrical spaces basically, but it's not, although it's not mentioned here. So one thing, another thing you have to, consider is the bending radius of the cables. Generally the bending radius of cables are eight times of the diameter of the cable. So always you have to maintain space enough to have the bending radius of the cable. If you take 70 millimeter cable, like 300 millimeter square meter cable has a 70 millimeter diameter. So you need 17 to 8 times bending radius for that cable. So this is about the fuel. Sri Lanka normally use petrol, diesel, kerosene, furnace oil 800, 1500, and furnace oil but 3500, but we call as heavy fuel. So generally, other than few places, actually power stations generally transport by bowser, and storage tank required for the fuel need to be based on consumption. You may have boilers, generators, so you need to calculate what is your consumption, and then replenishment time. So whether you can get it in 4 hours or you need 3 days, so you have to consider that one. And the bowser capacity, generally Sri Lanka bowser normal capacity is 13,600, and it has 4 compartments. So the minimum amount of fuel you can take is 3,400 liters. So when you build your tank farm or tank capacity tank, so you have to consider it has to be multiple of this one. So if you build a 15,000 tank, 15,000 capacity tank, so you need to have free board on the tank, free space on top of the tank. So you can, when the tank level goes down by 6,800, you can make another order for 6,800. So fill-in point of this fuel tank should not be less than 4.3 meters in any building boundary. So when you site in the storage tank, you have to think about this distance. Generally, fuel tanks need 110% spill tank, but I don't know, this is not practiced in petroleum corporation tank, normally in our filling stations. But factories, we all practice this one. We have a 110 capacity spill tank. If there's a spillage, actually it will remain in the spill tank. And this spill tank to be closed properly with a lock. If water is collected, generally actually it is dived directly. You don't release it directly to the outside. You send it to a water separator before discharge. If you have fuel tanks in a basement of a building, you need to have a sprinklers, and you need to get advice from the authority having the jurisdiction for fire, that is the fire department. Generally, if you have a fuel tank or any combustible material like fuel or LP gas in a basement, you need to have a sprinklers. Sometimes actually they specify to have a foam sprinklers. This is because the access for the fire brigade and fire team for the basement is to be not easy. So because of that, they specify additional requirement for this. These are approximate distances from a building from a fuel tank. Any building 3 meters, ignition source 6 meters. And if you want more details, you can go to NFPA 30, which is a flammable and combustible liquid portion. This LPG, we have two regulations in Sri Lanka published by SLS, there are two SLS standards regarding LPG, and also NFPA 58 is actually it's a more advanced document for LPG. According to Sri Lankan regulations, according to our fire regulations, if the building is having more than 16 apartments, you have to have centralized LPG distribution system. Or in all these 16 apartments, if you can have place, separate place, open for the exterior,
So you can place, you can have individual LPG cylinders. Otherwise, you have to go for a centralized LPG system. Generally, LPG underground piping, you need to have minimum depth of 375 of ground cover depth. If it is going, LPG pipes are going through a public area, you have to maintain 450 depth. Above ground, you need to make sure those are protected from physical damages. Above the ceiling, you can run gas lines, LPG, but you need to make sure those pipes are welded. So ceiling voids can be used as LPG, pipe in LPG. Meter room in an apartment actually need to be located in a well ventilated place. Generally, storage in Sri Lanka, we get LPG standard cylinders, that is 12 kilogram and 35 kilogram, and also bulk tanks. So you can install the bulk tank either indoor or outdoor. These are the separation distances given in ITAD publication fire regulations. Any vessel in the group, that is we have given in the liters, capacity in liters. Normally they in LPG they give it in water liters, actually equivalent water liters, 150 to 500, that is 0.05 ton. Separation distance you have to maintain 2.5, that is between vessels actually. If with a firewall you can reduce it down to 0.3 meters. So likewise 500 to 2500, and these are the distance. If you have a LPG bulk tank, if your building is very tall, the distance is very large, then you will not be able to directly distribute sometimes actually LPG without a vaporizer. Sometimes you will have to have a vaporizer to put it into the vapor form. So that will need additional space, but those things actually we have to in MEP areas. Actually, we have to work with actual dimension with suppliers in certain times, because it always depends on the available equipments. This is again LPG storage and separation distance given in FPA 58. As I mentioned, it's a more advanced document. It has more details about it. Piping and distances and all this. Fire detection and protection. So we categorize low rise building as buildings which are lower than 18 meters, medium rise between 18 meters and 30 meters, high rise between 30 meters and 45 meters, and super high rise above 40 meters. Low rise below 18 meters, medium rise between 18 and 30 meters, high rise building between 30 and 45 meters, and super high rise above. Recently introduced super high rise as above 45 meters. So we need to make sure when accessibility, we provide the accessibility for the fire brigade. If the cubical extent of the building is less than 7100, that is approximate area is like this is in meters, square meters, and this is in square feet, you need 1/4 of the perimeter must be, fire brigade must be able to access through 1/4 of the perimeter. So there must be a access way in 1/4 of the perimeter. If the cubical extent of the building is between 7100 cubic meters and 28400 cubic meters, roughly, like if you take 3.2 height of a building, then you get 2200 square meters to 8875 square meters building. So again, you need 1/4 of the perimeter. Likewise, between this 28,000 and 56, you need half of the perimeter. Between 56,000 and 86, you need 3/4 of the perimeter. Between 8,000 and 13,000, entire premises, entire perimeter, you have to provide the access for the fire brigade. You have to have with the road access for the fire brigade. Minimum access point actually not for the fire brigade, actually for a person. It has to be 850 width and 1000 millimeter high access point. For a building with habitable height less than 18, access road must be 4 meter wide, and there is no requirement for a hard landing is required. So hard landing is required when there's a fire. Actually, they bring a separate vehicle and they for the evacuation they use that hard landing. For building with habitable height more than 18 meters, access road must be 4.8. Hard landing must be 6 into 15 meters. Hard landing must be capable of taking sustained 40 ton stationary load. And radius must be less than 1 into 15. There must be an overhead clearance of 5 to 6 feet. And outer radius of the accessway must be a turning circle of 10.5 meters. The fire brigade must be able to turn the vehicle with a turning radius of 10.5 meters. And fire command center. This is actually required for high rise building. High rise buildings are buildings more than 30 meters. You need to have any building. You need to have the main fire panel at the entrance. Because whenever fire department enters, they must be able to access the fire panel and detect where the fire is, and all the signals, communication. But specifically for high rise building, we have to have a fire command center. And the minimum area required for the fire command center is 10 square meters. So fire command center generally includes control and display of status of detection and alarm and the communication system, emergency voice alarm communication system, two-way telephone communication, whichever is applicable. These are the required fire protection types. Hose fields are required for if the building is hose fields are required except for purpose group 1. You don't want a hose field for a building having dwellings, that is residential units, less than four stories or less than 18 meters. Or if the building floor area is less than 300 square feet, then you don't want hose field. Medium rise buildings between 18 and 30, you need hose fields. High rise buildings between 30 and 45 meters, again you need hose fields. And super high rise building above 45 meters, you need hose fields. Wet riser, that is you get a wet riser either 100 millimeter or 150 millimeter diameter wet riser. There are different risers, wet risers and dry risers, but in Sri Lanka we use wet risers. The cold countries actually they use dry risers. For buildings, medium rise building which are between 18 and 30 meters, you need wet riser. Basically, any building above 18 meters, you need wet riser. Sprinklers, you require sprinklers for the buildings more than 30 meters, high rise buildings and super high rise building. But there are certain instances, actually, even sometimes fire department requests sprinklers for buildings less than 30 meters. We'll see what are those. Hose fields are required for any building except purpose group 1, that residential building less than 4 stories or 18 meters, building less than 300 square feet. Permanently fixed, preferably along scape, hose fields
must be permanently fixed and preferably on the escape routes or corridors. All areas must be reached with a 6 mm throw. Cabinet generally is steel construction and you must be able to open with a 180 swing. You can mount it either post steel cabinets are mount either recess or surface. So this is a picture of this is a wall mounted type and this is a recess type. Typical dimension 800 and depth is 300. Wet riser for any building which is more than 18 meters, riser sizes 100 millimeter riser for medium rise building, that is between 18 meters and 30 meters you have to have 100 millimeter size for the riser, and above 30 meters you have to have 150 millimeter riser. Number of risers, it is depend on the area. For every 900 square meters or part of it you need one wet riser. So if you have 1200 square meters then you have to have two wet risers in that floor, so in that building. Positioning to be located within the dedicated fire duct, any part of the floor within 60 meters from the riser. So any part of the building must be 60 meters within the riser. Within the protected ventilated or smoke free lobby, otherwise immediately outside the protected staircase if there is no protected or protected smoke free lobby. Wet riser must be connected to breaching valve which is used by the fire authority, fire department. It must be located within 18 meters from the access road at a 1 meter height. Positioning of the landing valve. So landing valves are fixed to the wet risers. Generally fixing height is between 1200 and 750 millimeter. There must be a side clearance of 150 generally. These are approximate distances. Clearance below the center line of the landing valve. Center line of the landing valve is 230. Clearance above the handwheel, there must be a clearance of 200 millimeters. Clearance between the edge of the female coffin of landing valve, this one, and the face of the wall must be less than 75 millimeters. So it must be deep than 75 millimeters. Sprinklers are required where all the buildings which are more than 30 meters. Other than that, actually, even for 18 to 30 meters actually, fire department may specify where proper compartmentation is not achieved. Basement and basements used for public resorts, shops, offices or factory or any warehouse. Used for any high hazardous purposes. But basements, if your basement is basement car parks for the basements, if 50% of the sides are permanently open, you don't want sprinklers. Fire pumps. You need two separate fire pumps. One for the sprinklers, the other one for the wet riser. But there are exceptions actually. Fire department can waive this one, and actually they have the authority to instruct you to use one pump. Generally, you have to use positive suction pump for the sprinklers. Wet riser also positive suction. If it is not possible, you can use a separate prime tank. This is what is mentioned in the Sri Lankan regulations. But actually, NFPA it is not a must. Actually, there are different pumps you can use for that. Consideration in sizing the fire pump room. You have to have space defined by the manufacturer. Clearance around equipment to
element permanent construction including other installed equipment and appliances shall be sufficient to allow inspection service repair without removing such an element permanent construction, without removing permanent construction or disabling the function of the required fire resistance rated assembly. Pump room door must be enough to remove the largest piece of the equipment. There must be drain for the pump room, undisturbed flow of water for the undisturbed flow water flow for the impeller. So generally you have to have a straight runoff before the pump. You have to have straight runoff at least 10 times the diameter of the inlet pipe. These are the water capacities provisions, water provisions you have to keep for the fire. Hose seals 2000 liters, wet risers 45,000 cubic meters, sprinklers you need 55, depends on the hazard category, so it can go from 55,000 to 245,000 liters. And also for super high rise and super high risers, additional connection for the fire department to fill the sand. So you have a breaching valve, so they are asking additional breaching valve. To generally breaching valve is connected to the riser, wet riser. Now they are asking additional valve to fill the water into your sump in case of high risers and super high risers. If you are taking domestic water from the same tank, fire tank, so the domestic tank must be above this water level. If your requirement is 45 cubic meters, domestic suction valve of the domestic pump must be, suction pipe of the domestic pump must be fixed above this minimum fire requirement, whatever.
Firefighting shafts. The purpose of firefighting shaft is provide quick, safe and protected access route for the firefighters. You need a firefighting shaft for all the buildings more than 30 meters. The firefighting shaft also used as the means of escape. Component of the firefighting shafts are protected enclosure having firefighting stairway, firefighting lobby and firefighting lift. Firefighting lifts, you need firefighting lift, fire lift, we call fire lift, for buildings more than 30 meters. It has to be located in a fire protected shaft. Each lobby serving the fire lift to be protected. If you have other lifts also in the same lobby, so all the floors of the shaft must be protected, because otherwise it will other lift who must may become a transferring of smoke into this area. Fire lift must be preferably located adjacent to the staircase enclosure. Approach to the lift, each level should through a protected ventilated lobby. So these are, you have to consider these requirements actually, firefighting lift, smoke free lobby, firefighting lift, firefighting lobby and firefighting stairway for buildings more than 30 meters. Then when it comes to telecommunication services, you have to keep a provision for the telecommunication services in a building. Those are main telecommunication room, what we call as MTR, for the fixed services. Then you have to have another room or space for the mobile services, GSM services, or you can have a combined room for those. Then you have to have a rooftop mobile room. Each floor you have to have a telecommunication closet, and then each home or office, if it's apartment, each home, if it's an office, in each office you have to have a separate consolidation cabinet, or what you call MDF, mainframe, main distribution frame. So these are schematic diagram of with a separate MTR, main telecommunication room, and mobile service room. Ducts or cable trays, these are ducts or the cable trays. So you have a main telecommunication room here.
So you have a separate mobile service room here, and each floor you have a flow telecommunication closet room, closet here in, and every 10th floor you have a mobile telecommunication room where you need to boost your mobile telecommunication strength. Then you get each apartment or each office unit, you get separate distribution boards.
Main telecommunication room and mobile service room used for the termination of telecom fiber optic cables to house telecom equipment if needed. Provide on the ground floor for multi-story buildings. Generally, we provide in the main telecommunication room is provided in the ground floor. If mobile service room is required in the building, generally first mobile service landing room can be shared with the main telecommunication room. If there is a mobile the requirement for a mobile service room, so you can combine and have it in the main telecommunication room. So you have to provide mobile service rooms in every 10th floor. These are general guidelines, but sometimes it may vary from telecommunication service provider to service provider.
Main telecommunication room sizes for the fixed services are up to 600 apartments or offices. Generally, you need 3 by 3 by 3 meters. If it's a residential, 3 by 3 by 3. It's a commercial and mix, it's a 3 by 4 by 3. If the residential unit, these units are 600 to 200, that's 1200, you need 4 by 4 by 3, and this is 4 by 4 by 3. More than 1200, you have to separately get the requirement. So this is a layout of a main telecommunication room. So you get a raised floor, and you have this fire protection extinguishers, and you have a telecom racks there, and you have to provide a cleaner for this one. Generally, ELB services need cleaner and smoke detector. And this is main telecommunication room, residential, commercial. This is a typical diagram to get an idea. Fixed services, only the fixed services up to 1200 units. So you need 4 by 4 by room, 4 by 4 room, and you have 4 racks in this one, and again it's a raised floor, and you get a bench also to empty the fiber cable. Main telecommunication room, that is combined fixed and mobile services. Again, you can go up to 1200 units. You need something like 5 by 4 meter room with racks. And you may have to have, it's again dependent on UPS and backup battery pack also to be located. If mobile service rooms are separately, so you have to have mobile 3 by 3 meter mobile service rooms in each 10th floor.
Every 10th floor. These are the telecommunication closets in each floor. Multi-story building, generally you need 2 by 1 telecommunication closet. From where all the cables are distributed to the corresponding floor.
If it's a single story, it's a small one, 300 by 300 and depth of 150 millimeters. These are the units actually, distribution boards, distribution panels or IDF, which is fixed in separate offices or houses. Generally, those are 600 millimeter wide and 600 millimeter wide, and this is a 12U, height 12U is 12U, 1U is actually 1.75 inches into 12. That one, then 150 millimeter depth. So this is when you have 24 UTP terminations. If you have 24 RJ45 connections, you have to go for this type of this size cabinet. And if you have more than 24, you have to have a higher dip for that. There must be riser in the multi-story buildings to allow from the main telecom room to the floor telecommunication process. You need to have a riser for that one, and also to run the mobile services from the rooftop to mobile service room. So generally, these are designed closets should be designed so that they are vertically aligned within the building.
Cable containment.
In the main riser, generally you can use a hot dip galvanized slotted steel cable tray. Ideally two cable trays, fiber 500 millimeter width and 100 millimeter depth cable tray with slotted steel, so you can tie the fiber. And for GSM cable, that is mobile telecommunication, you need like 300 millimeter, 550 millimeter depth cable tray having this one. Within vertical connected homes, if there are homes or offices connected vertically, then you can use 50 millimeter PVC container. Cable containment horizontally, when cable comes to the floor closet, from there you have to distribute horizontally. For that one, mobile service providers, you need 150 millimeter wide, 50 millimeter cable tray. Heavy duty cable tray. Within the homes, you can typically use a 1-inch. Within homes or offices, you can use 1-inch PVC cable. Server rooms. Generally, server rooms are located above the floodplain or storm surge levels, preferably above the ground floor. You should completely avoid water pipes in the server room. There should not be any water pipe above the ceiling in the server rooms. And also, it is very important for server rooms to free from electromagnetic interference, electrical transformers, copiers, radio transmitters, microwave transmission, electrical motors, electronic ballasters. You must avoid in the vicinity. Also, you should provide a drain in raised floors in case if there's a problem. The water must be able to drain the water. Generally, between the server racks, you need to provide 1.2 meter distance, and you need 900 millimeter in front of the rack door. Air conditions are very critical in server rooms, and server room design is a completely different subject. These are not very high-tech servers, and if one of the officers in high-rise building has a server room, so you can apply these numbers. Generally, you need to maintain 21 degrees temperature in a server room and RH of 50% and during 24-hour basis operation. You need backup HVAC facility, so you have to have separate air condition in case the first air condition fail, automatically the second one must come into operation. The airflow, you must allow the airflow to come from front and to back of the panel and escape from here. So generally, air conditioning server rooms are so done in, as I mentioned earlier, done in the raised floor, under the raised floor. So your supply comes from here and pull this one and take it for from there. So for the server rooms, you need 100% redundancy generally. Servers, most of the servers nowadays, they has dual power feeds. So you have to have two power supplies. If there's a failure in one power supply, so the server will take the power supply automatically from the other one without shutting down. This is just a layout of a computer server room for a 200 room hotel property. Generally, we should avoid external windows. We need minimum 2.4 meter height from the finished floor level to the finished face floor level to the ceiling to accommodate 42U rack. These are server racks, this is a workstation, and this is a race room. This again layout for 300 to 500 property room property hotel. Manager's room, standard workstations, observation window, ramp. You need a ramp because you have a race course, there will be a ramp. Cable phase, you can run the cable phase above this one, and race course and HVAC. These are the intermediate distribution frames, that's what we call IDF. In locations, intermediate IDF locations, generally in hotels, we place in back of the house areas, offices in common areas, apartments in common areas. If it is IDF for the particular house, it will be within the house, but if it is for the common services, it will be in the common area. Factories, generally in common areas, but in a secure place. It must be, places must be dust free, preferably air conditioned, because we need to maintain a temperature below 30, and we have to maintain our RH 30 and 75. So we may have to air condition to get this RH rate. Dimension, generally you need 1.8 meter by 2.4 footprint for 100 outlets, that is 100 UTP connections. Generally for the IDF, we are using PVC conduits, so you have to have bending radius of 10 times of the internal diameter of the conduit. But certain areas I haven't covered, like sump capacities I haven't covered in this one, water sumps. Sump capacity, when you want to estimate the water sump capacity, you have the fire requirement. On top of that, actually you have the water consumption, that water consumption per person, depending on the hotel, whether it's a hotel or office. Actually you can get it from, there are standards, like office 45 liters per person. A hotel, it varies from 180 to 250. When a hotel, you have to add into that one the kitchen requirements and gardening and water loss from water usage for the cooling towers. So you can estimate the total requirement for the water. And then what you have to do is, actually you need to keep a storage for two days or 3 days. Generally we keep 2 days. So you have to estimate the requirement based on that one. And then if you have an overhead tank, generally in overhead tank sizing, what we do is days required, 1/3 of the day's requirement is provided in the overhead tank. But actually you can designer can take a call on that one, and he can change that. That's a thumb rule, 1/3 of the day's requirement is kept in the overhead tank. STPs, sewer treatment plants, generally we use 90%, 85 to 90% of the total water consumption as the capacity of the STPs. Based on that one, actually we size the STP capacity. Those are related to plumbing. So that's end of my session. Thank you very much. If you have anything, I think any questions I can clarify.
Avoided in the office areas, then we go for my subscription system. there a particular regulation on that? Or
these no? Sprinkler systems in electrical areas? Oh, officers.
Office areas, general office spaces, like maybe something like this. If you have workstations there.
It's a requirement. It's requirement says actually if the building is more than 30 meters, it's mandated to have an office. I don't know where it has been available. Generally, it is not allowed.
I heard somebody was talking about that. It's generally not allowed. That's what I know.
Not allowed. About 30 meters, it's mandated to have. But between 18 and 30, it's not required. But certain buildings actually don't have enough escape routes. If you don't have corridor width, then actually they can specify that there are no two staircases, then they can, fire department can specify even for 18 to 30 buildings, specify a sprinklers, at least for certain escape routes.
One more question, since you are in Ashway, we're giving a light here, CO2 levels I have gone through, I tried to find out details of the CO2 level, which is expected level, that's it. Which one is exactly? I don't see any regulation or standards as such. Which one should be taken into consideration? Should it be 700 or some say it's even between the outside and the inside comparison is 700 or 600? Even some say we can go up to 1000 ppm. Which one?
Sorry, I won't be able to answer the question now, actually. Can I come back to you, Raj, later?
Yes, sir. Yes.
I have a question also. This presentation, the high speed is really important. Is there any, like, handbook or anything that can be those materials?
Because actually, when you come to this space planning, you can't find any single book actually. What I have done is actually I have gone through several materials and prepared this up. There's no such a single book you can get all the details. So I have referred certain Sri Lankan books. In the absence of Sri Lankan books, I have gone to, these electrical, those are NEC actually, requirements. In Sri Lanka actually you can't find that one. So it's a combination of different things.
Yes, thank you.
Sorry?
Can we request you to
make? Yes, okay. I will try to important data, I will try to get into a few pages and distribute it.
That is really important.
Okay,
then I have another question. Like, for the high-rise building, because let's say more than 50 or 60 stories, when the superlight or toilet is so light,
no, you have to have speed breakers actually. High rise buildings actually you have to have speed breakers. So generally high rise buildings you are gravity lines you install speed breakers. Then actually when you design, you decide the size of the, especially the vertical ducts actually, the speed breakers need a fair amount of actually building speed. So you have to provide that requirement.
Like toilet exhaust also, we cannot go for a high level, can be exhausted between levels?
Yeah, you can do that.
Can refuge floor, is that called refuge floor?
There will be refuge floor, yes. There's a requirement for a refuge floor in high rises. Presentation. Okay, I'll mail it to. I'll do. So,
there are certain sites which I have not taken, I mean, official presentation, I mean, extracted certain detail. So I will delete those details and maintain them. Those are mine.
Another one more thing I wanted to ask, that race law in the server room, the practice drainage, how to the drainage, any idea?
Sorry?
Drain like from the air, they have the air conditioning meeting computer room.
Yeah.
Is the drain line, is there any specific design for how the drain line is measuring underneath the drain floor?
So in server rooms actually you have to have drain lines actually.
Yeah.
So that's a requirement.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, but I mean like gradient or specific requirement for any gradient.
Yeah, you have to maintain the normal gradients like 1:100 gradient you have to maintain. My knowledge, it is not a mandatory requirement. They have published that one. I think that it's not mandatory. No.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Yeah.
Sir,
thank you.
We have arranged a gift of appreciation, token of appreciation to engineer Kosala Kamburadeniya. I would like to invite engineer Samantha Gunawardena, former president of building service sectional committee, to award that gift. And I would like to invite engineer Kosala Kamburadeniya to receive it. Thank you very much for engineer Kamburadeniya for valuable presentation and that awareness make to a group of engineers here. So on behalf of building service sectional committee, the institution of engineers, I would like to give my thanks to ISL staff who make this arrangement to become successful this session. Then the today here not present, I think, building service sectional committee engineer Narangad also, he also made very much effort to make this event successful. Then finally those audience, all of engineers, thank you very much for coming attending this session. Thank you very much.